Hello everybody and welcome to another Anime Thoughts and Opinions video. Disclaimers that used to be listed at the beginning of these videos are now listed at the top of the description down below. Those disclaimers can give you a clearer image of the style of discussion video that I do for this series. This is it. This will be the last Thoughts and Opinions video that I ever do. No. I just woke up. I had like a couple hours of sleep, of a nap. And I'm not really sure if I should go back to sleep or not. So if I sound like I am a bit tired, that might be why. But it is the 4th of April right now, and that is 2023. And we are going to be talking about Dr. Stone, Stone Wars. So how this came about was Dr. Stone, Stone Wars is kind of like... I guess it's not technically called Season 2, it's more or less like an expansion of Season 1. And it released in 2021, so it's already a couple years old, right? And I remember watching Dr. Stone, we talked about it here on the channel, it's in the Thoughts and Opinions series. And I had watched it with a friend back then, and that same person is like rewatching, I guess watching through all of Dr. Stone stuff in preparation for the new season that's coming out in like a couple days. And so they asked if I wanted to watch the Dr. Stone stuff that I haven't seen yet along with them, and so I decided in the end to tag along. And to be completely honest, I did not remember when I had actually watched Dr. Stone. I was like, oh, I mean, maybe a year ago. It's been a little while. I kind of remember, you know, it was like spring when we watched it. That's not too long ago. It's been 3 years. 3 years. Real life years. You know? April 8th. So, I mean, okay, we're four days away from being 3 exact years, but it has basically been 3 years since I watched Dr. Stone. What the fuck? I don't remember that. I don't remember it being that long ago. I guess that's just how time works. What I do remember, though, it makes sense because I do remember getting, I think I got my new microphone early that year, and I was using it for the very first time when we started watching Dr. Stone. But regardless, so it's been 3 years, and that was kind of a shocker to me, but Dr. Stone, Stone Wars... is a television show of 11 episodes in length, so nowhere near as long as the first season of the show. 24 minutes per episode, and it started releasing on the 14th of January, 2021, and lasted until the 25th of March, 2021. And it's listed on Analyst as an action-adventure comedy sci-fi show. Now, I apologize... Oh, by the way, the studio is TMS Entertainment. Now, I apologize if this video ends up being a little bit shorter than probably originally expected. I think my original Dr. Stone video came out to around about 40-something minutes, and a link to that will be in the description below if you are coming into this one not having heard my thoughts and opinions on the original season of the show. But keep in mind that while normally I would say, oh, well, that gives you context for my thoughts and opinions, you know, in the sequels and stuff, I don't really remember what I said about Dr. Stone. Dr. Stone is one of those shows where it's not a bad thing, mind you, but it's one of those shows where I actually didn't retain a lot of memories of it. Now, that's not usually the case for most shows I watch, no matter how long has passed, you know, sure, over great periods of time, I'm not going to remember it to a T, but Dr. Stone specifically, I kind of had a lot of trouble remembering what happened in the first season. And I had to go back through my old analyst entry notes to kind of refresh some of my memory on the way that I thought, like, how I apparently really liked the soundtrack and the kind of laid-back and chill comedy that the show had, among other things. And I kind of had to revise my memories of what happened in the story. And that was especially important when it came to finishing Stone Wars and figuring out, did I like this more? Because that was the issue that I had. When we finished Stone Wars, I sat there on my analyst. I mean, we finished, I think, like 2 days ago, but I only just made the entry today. And I sat there, and I genuinely was thinking for like an hour, did I like this more or less than the season one? I don't remember, because I don't really remember what I talked about there. So I had to go through all the process of trying to refresh my brain. And once I did that, I kind of came to the conclusion that Stone Wars isn't bad. Stone Wars is pretty good. To me, it kind of feels like just an ending to the story of the first show, I guess, kind of. Or at least one of the arcs. I don't remember beat for beat how the story goes in the first season. But from what I can place is that Stone Wars is good. It's just not as good as the first season, in my opinion. I think that I prefer season one of the show. When I look at how many episodes that had and all of the things that happen in the story and the more moments you get to have and then some of the memorable moments that have stuck with me, like, you know, when Suika takes her melon off for the first time, that was pretty funny. That's never left my brain. And Stone Wars is a lot shorter and kind of, I guess, prepares the story for where it's going to be going next. And then it also kind of wraps up I wouldn't say it kind of, but it basically wraps up the rivalry, that's I guess the word I'm looking for, between Senku and Tsukasa. And that's really all it focuses on. With, you know, a couple more, it felt exactly like what I do remember of Dr. Stone, where it's basically just, you know, a progression of the characters kind of, oh, now we're gonna make, you know, something new with all this science-y crap. And, you know, it's fun to watch the characters build the stuff. It's fun to watch, like, the village folks help out. And you get that here. You know, you go from, I think the very first thing that they do, that Senku does, is make quote-unquote space food, like a ramen alternative, or excuse me, they make, like, space food. I think it's freeze-dried food or something like that they do to prolong it. I'm not really sure. I'm trying to remember if they, because I wrote down ramen, but they had apparently already had ramen in the first season, and so I don't remember how they made the quote-unquote space food. I thought it was that they ended up freeze-drying it, and then all you needed to do was, like, add, you know, the warm water to it or something like that, and then it's basically fully edible. I don't know, I've never had freeze-dried pasta before. Wait, have I? No, I have not. But yeah, okay, I wrote down freeze-dried cup ramen was one of the first things that we got to see. And then when it comes to actually taking down Tsukasa's base, where he has set up shop around the Miracle Cave, which is where, you know, basically the show had begun back in the day, where the revival fluid is being formed, Senku has, like, made this promise that the raid will be, you know, it'll be a bloodless battle, nobody's going to die, and stuff like that, nobody's going to get seriously hurt. And while there is actually some blood drawn during the fight that you do get, they create, like, a steam-powered car that then they turn into a makeshift tank. So that's another thing that happens. I think they make, like, paper alternatives at some point. And, I don't know, a lot of that kind of stuff happens. Point is, though, it's fun to watch the characters do this shit. That is something I do remember from the first season of the show, and that never changed here. Now, surprisingly, there's also the whole telephone thing. If we remember the two characters from the first season, Taiju, I believe his name was, and fucking, what the hell's her name? Yuzu Riha, I guess? Yuzu, I'll refer to for simplicity's sake right now. I remember these two characters being, like, there at the beginning of the first season, and then they were kind of sent off to Tsukasa's base to be, like, undercover, you know? And then you never see them again. Excuse me. You never really see them again. Well, they show up now as actual supporting cast. And they set up communication with Senku through, like, this long-range telephone thing that's buried underground beneath a... that's one of the first kind of things we get to watch a group of our characters do, is sneak in to Tsukasa's territory and basically plant this phone device in a fake grave that was made for Senku. Since obviously Tsukasa, I remember them having some sort of thing where he believes that Senku's dead. So, you know, obviously he's not. And there were some scenes, like, they do flashback a couple moments from the first season. I'm like, oh yeah, I remember that. It literally doesn't feel like 3 fucking years ago, but I do remember seeing that. I do remember that scene playing out. So, nose itches here. Can we not do that right now, please? So, you know, the gist of the show is kind of preparing for battle, preparing for this fight that they're going to have. And, you know, it's like... The thing, I think I remember saying in the first season something along the lines of, like, obviously Dr. Stone is, while I can enjoy any show, just like I can enjoy any song as long as my ears like it, Dr. Stone doesn't really rely on a lot of the things that I yearn for in anime, right? It's not thick in drama, it's not very emotional, it's not very, you know, it's not very violent or anything, but it is fun. So, and that fun is still entertaining for me, which is probably why I'm able to enjoy Dr. Stone to the amount that I do. But there is some pretty good moments. Like, I said in my notes for the first season that there are moments in the show, despite it not focusing on those types of themes. There are moments that can, you know, kind of grab you by the balls. And Stone Wars is no exception to that rule. There are moments that can catch you off guard. So I'm not going to go through, like, every single new character. I'm just going to kind of talk about the conflict itself, the actual battle that they have a little bit, and then kind of briefly go through my notes, because I don't really have too many notes here. I mean, this show's 11 episodes, right? I've watched, like, I've seen shows in the past that, you know, are shorter than the usual 12 to 13 episodes, sure, but I've seen multiple shows recently, like, in a row, that are only 11 episodes. You know, like, 86 was only 11 episodes. And now, of course, I can't remember whatever the hell else I've seen that was only... The Promised Neverland Season 2 was only 11 episodes. I guess 11 episodes is just what people do, you know, over the past couple years. But, thankfully, there's already an established story here and already established characters, so I don't have a situation like 86 where they give me 11 episodes to give a shit about anybody and also try to drop a million, you know... pieces of information on me and still expect me to be able to have any time to care for any of the characters. So here, the pre-established cast, it's just a continuation, so it works perfectly fine. Long story short, the moments that I think I enjoyed the most here were not necessarily the battles, but Tsukasa and Senku's reunion, which is kind of like, you know, haha, I am big bad Final Fantasy character versus haha, I am big brain smart. It kind of ends pretty abruptly, pretty fast. But what's cool is that Tsukasa, who is kind of like, from what I remember, he's kind of like, I don't want to say he's a Final Fantasy villain. He just kind of has that facial shape to him. You know, I've always kind of used this as a joke where I talk about the antagonist of a show being a Final Fantasy villain when they look like, or they have these ideals, like, I will save the world by destroying it, you know? He's not really like that. He just kind of looks like a Final Fantasy villain, visually, you know? But what's cool about his character is that he's actually kind of revealed here to not just be an asshole, you know? He has a backstory. We get to see his backstory. We get to learn about why he smashes statues, you know, and why he does what he does, you know, why he's wanted to reject a world of science and stuff. And it has to do with his little sister, I guess, that was in the hospital, who Senku basically ends up saving and revives successfully, which I guess I had forgotten about this, but I guess the revival fluid, like, does something with the human body and kind of fixes issues that they might have, you know, like if they were injured and then they get stoned and then they get unstoned, some of those injuries have been healed over time, I guess. I don't know. Whatever. It does that. So she gets woken up. Tsukasa and Senku kind of have a bit of an emotional talk. We get to learn about Tsukasa's backstory and the importance of his little sister. It is his little sister, right? I think it is. And we get to learn, like, how he came from a pretty fucked up background of, like, I guess his parents were abusive. I'm not sure if it was his father that was, like, beating the shit out of him or just random people. It looks like his mother is either not around or just doesn't care. And his little sister is in the hospital with who the hell knows what kind of problems, right? And ultimately, the story comes to an end because Tsukasa's right-hand man, I guess, named... What the hell is this guy's name? Okay, I guess his name is it Hyuga? Hyuga, I guess? He wears, like, a mask and never opens his fucking eyes, except when you know shit's getting real. He ends up stabbing Tsukasa during one of the fights, and turns out that this stab is not something that you can just heal willy-nilly. It's not, you know, it's not like an, oh, you got a flesh wound, we're just gonna heal it, you know, at the end of this episode, and then you'll be patched up and all ready to go in the next episode. Turns out he's gonna die. It's a fatal wound. It's gonna kill him, right? So, but to save him, in an attempt to save him, Senku has this plan that, you know, we will, the whole stoning process heals you, so we're going to stone you again, but we don't know how, so until we do know how, we're going to basically cryogenically freeze your body, which will kill him, but I guess it's in an attempt to save him later. I don't get that. You know, I guess this is just something I have to accept because it's anime. If you kill him, yes, I get that in, you know, I don't know if we have ever perfected the ability to freeze something and then unfreeze it later and it's alive still. I've always been under the impression that we have not had that ability, that technology. So if you freeze him and he dies just to hope that it preserves his body in time, you know, for long enough that whenever they learn how to stone people, they will just stone him, and then because his body was kept in, you know, preserved for however many ever years it takes to learn that ability, the stone will just end up repairing him, I guess, repairing any issues, and he's just brought back to life. I mean, if you're dead, you're dead, okay? When something freezes, your brain dies. There's nothing you do about that after that point. You know, I don't think we have ever been able to save anybody's life. We've been able to save people after they've quote-unquote died, but only if the brain has not suffered damages yet. Which means you have a very small window of time. So I'm guessing that's why they freeze him. But freezing kill, you know, whatever. I don't know. I don't get it, but that's what they're going to do, right? Okay. Regardless, though, there's a pretty touching scene between Senku and Tsukasa where they're kind of, you know, they want to be left alone during this, which I was like, oh, that's kind of powerful to have a scene like that in Dr. Stone, you know, especially between rivals, right? And I guess now the new big bad that had ran off was Hyuga, and also the character Hamura, I guess, which I guess is that pink haired girl. They also end up blowing up the Miracle Cave with explosives at one point, which I was under the impression that this now meant they don't have any more revival fluid, like, period. I don't know if I must have missed where, if they ever said, like, oh, well, we can still collect it, or we just need to rebuild the place. I know it comes from, like, bat guano or something like that, but that's something that happens. That's an important piece of the story there, too. And another moment that I really liked during it is before the battle, the character Chrome, who's kind of like the village idiot. I don't want to say idiot, that's too strong a word, but he's kind of like the village loudmouth, right? This character kind of surprised the hell out of me. He gets captured at one point and put in like a little bamboo prison cell in Tsukasa's base. And, you know, all of the characters are like trying to prepare to go and save him. And this is like when they're designing the tank and stuff. And the thing is, though, is he gets out on his own. He not only does he get a little bit of help from a new character from within inside Tsukasa's ranks, who's like this new bow-wielding character that has incredible hearing, apparently, who's basically been kind of planning things out since the very beginning, has this, gives him like an electric battery. But Chrome uses his wits of what he's learned from being around Senku and kind of, you know, just his own intelligence or intellect, and even though it's still nowhere near the levels of Senku, he manages to escape the prison on his own and get out of the base on his own and get back on his own. That was really surprising to me. It's not often, basically what I had said in my notes was, it's not often that you get to see the village loudmouth or the village goof actually be smart, you know, like that. That was pretty cool. He reminds me a lot of George Not Found, which is funny to me, because I think I started watching George Not Found and Dream and stuff around that same time, but before I had started watching the first season of Dr. Stone. But it was in 2020 when I came across them, so I don't know, watching him now, he's got that short brown hair, he screeches every other scene, you know, he's got the, like, almost the same energetic personality. But he actually got some nice stuff to do, and he even gets some nice stuff to do in the next Dr. Stone thing, the special episode. There's moments with a new character named Nikki, who is like one of the first that they end up. What's the word here? Come on, brain. What's the word I'm looking for? I keep wanting to say transform, but that's not what I want to say. They bring from Tsukasa's ranks into, you know, the Kingdom of Science's ranks by tricking her, or I say tricking in quotations, by the character Gen pretends to be Lillian, from which, okay, that whole thing was all played out in the first season. I do remember that. In order to trick her into being like, oh, Lillian is still alive in the United States, you know, they've come back from the Age of Stone, and they're coming to save us and all this shit, you know. But she's so much of a super, she just happens to be a super fan of Lillian's that she knows that it's actually not really her. But the fact that Senku was able to recreate a record of one of her songs, and they even upgraded it, I think, at one point, where it's now even a clearer image in quotations, it's a clearer audio quality, and it just moves her like music can do. It can just do that sometimes, and so she does still end up agreeing to come over, and they're going to use this tactic on some of the other folks in the group. But yeah, so there is plenty of stuff that happens here. I don't ever remember standing around for in the first season, and you never stand around for the 11 episodes here. They're always moving forward. With the show coming to an end, it's, you know, in preparing for the next piece, it looks like, you know, we're going to be going out into the ocean with our plan to go across the ocean in an attempt to find the mysterious source of the light, the greenish light, I guess, that had turned everybody to stone, or that had appeared before everyone had turned to stone originally. Okay, a couple things here that are kind of exciting. Despite anything, I'm quite excited to see them go off into the ocean. I think that this is a great opportunity for adventure. There's always this sense of curiosity that comes from wanting to see more. You know, like in the first season, one of the most interesting aspects, according to my notes, I guess, was that I wanted to know, you know, the cause of this. You know, why did everyone turn to stone? What caused it and why? I said in my notes that chances are we'll never learn that, because I guess it's not really the point of the anime, which is fine, because I still think that what we get in the anime is okay. But I want to know, you know, I want to explore that. I think that would be really fun to explore. And I mean, it still is important to the story. I mean, the story exists because of this mysterious occurrence that had, well, occurred. So I still would like to explore that and see what happens, but... And it looks like at least we have not dropped that. We're still acknowledging that it is what happened, and it's something that, you know, is on apparently across the ocean on the other side of the planet. I guess we're going to the United States or something like that. We'll be taking a ship. So, great opportunity for expanding upon the story. But also cool, because anytime characters get on a ship to go anywhere in an adventure, you never know what you're going to come across. What's going to be in the United States? You know, what islands are they going to come across, if they come across any? You know, is there going to be people there? Are they going to be like tribals like we've got here in Japan? Or are they going to be more civilized? Are they going to be, you know, is there going to be a bigger group of them? Did this even happen to anyone outside? I mean, it's been 3.7 thousand years, and there's no way that any country on the planet would not come to the aid of Japan, or at least come to collect shit from Japan maliciously, if this happened to only one country. You know, you would say, well, what if news never got out that Japan turned to stone, but everywhere else was fine? Well, I would argue that when news stops coming out of a location as important as Japan, as important as, you know, a major country, that people are gonna kind of, you know, do the rocks raising eyebrow thing. You know, they're going to want to fucking know what the hell's going on there. So chances are the rest of the world has been stoned too for the past 3.7 thousand years or whatever. But still, the curiosity is there. What are they gonna find? I'm excited to see that. I think that'll be a lot of fun. I hope, the only thing I can hope is that we don't spend the whole next season on a ship and never actually get to the land, you know. That's the only thing I'm worried about a little bit, but we'll see where it goes. I'm not sure if I'm going to be watching Stone Wars Season 2 or whatever it's being called anytime soon. I don't think I'll be watching it as it's releasing along with the person that got me into Dr. Stone or whatever. Mainly because I've now started watching another show that is currently releasing, which I normally don't do, but I agreed to do, and it's been kind of a bit of fun so far, and I don't want to have multiple new shows that I'm watching at the same time, because then it'll be even more difficult to manage the notes down the road once they're finished, but we'll see. So, regardless, though, point is, I'm eager to see where the show goes from here, because it's going to expand the adventure aspect quite a bit. Some other cool stuff that you do learn kind of pops up in the special that we'll talk about in the next episode of the Anime Thoughts and Opinions. But, so, as for some of the other moments here that I wrote in my notes that I might as well just kind of bring up, first of all, I want to talk about, you know, the visuals. They seem exactly like what I remember. I don't think they've really changed anything with that. I talked about really liking the soundtrack, but to be honest, in Stone Wars, I don't remember the soundtrack. So I don't know if my opinion has just changed over time over the past 3 years, or if they just didn't really utilize the soundtrack like they did in the first season. I'm not actually sure about that. But I will tell you, the opening, I really like the opening. I actually listened to it after we had watched like the first episode or two. I actually went and listened to it on my own time, which is I usually don't do until we're finished with the show, because of spoiler reasons. I don't want things popping up in my recommended or whatever on YouTube that are like, oh, Senku gets his eyes poked out by, you know, Tsukasa. I didn't want that kind of thing to pop up. But I really like this. I actually like it way more than the first season's opening. I think it's a lot catchier. I like the beat that it's got. And so, okay, we talked about this, we talked about that, we talked about this, we talked about Taiju and Yuzu, who end up actually coming back to the Kingdom of Science by the end, of course, along with pretty much most of Tsukasa's men. The fake Lillian, we talked about that. Looks like I covered basically everything I kind of wrote down in my notes. They have until winter to stop Tsukasa's armory. I didn't mention that, but obviously they do stop it. There's a cool flashback scene where you get to see Tiger tanks. You get to see World War II. It's not animated. It's just a still screen. But I always find that so awesome whenever an anime just does some random flashback, you know, when they're talking and they show actual historical, like, footage. Well, I say actual footage, but I mean, you know, they accurately captured the image of a Tiger tank. You know, I thought that was just really awesome to see. I mean, I don't know. It's just like a lot of anime that does historical stuff, they kind of always do something weird with it, if that makes any sense, you know, like Yojo Senki, for example, which does its own universe, but based on our world wars, and so a lot of the stuff in it, you know, you've got like, I think if I remember correctly, that's the show that has like the V1 rocket, right? But it's got like 20 different fucking engines on it, or, you know, they do anime shit to it, right? It's still really cool, but you never actually get to see that accurately capture that image. I've always wanted just a straight World War II anime. I've always wanted one, right? There's been anime that take place in time periods around there. There's anime that has elements of the Second World War or make callbacks to it, you know. But there's never actually been one that just focuses solely on the World War II. Even if they take an anime story from it, they always have to do something weird with the technology. Just give me a fucking World War story, goddammit. Yojo Senki could have been amazing if they weren't little people flying around shooting tanks with magic. Like, for Christ's sake, they were this close. And I still like that show a lot, but they were this close from making it a fucking awesome show, in my opinion. Okay, I'm getting on a side tangent just because there's a frame of a Tiger tank in Dr. Stone Stone Wars. And it's not even fully on screen. It's like a tiny little piece of drawing in the bottom corner of it. Whatever. Anyways. There's this really funny scene for me where Suika, who still wears her melon, that if I remember correctly, the reason she still wears it is because Senku had installed like little crystal lenses, like glasses basically, into it for her, so that, because she has bad eyesight. But there's a moment where she kind of tucks herself in her melon and bounces and rolls around, which I thought was like adorably hilarious. I don't know, caught me off guard kind of. Chrome Escapes, we talked about that. We talked about Tsukasa and her story. Yuzu's secret mission. I didn't talk about this, but she's had this secret mission where she's actually putting together all of the statue people that Tsukasa crushes. So she goes out there and collects all the fragments and spends hours upon hours upon hours putting them back together, basically gluing them back together so that they can be saved, which, hey, if the show says it works, it works, okay? They do revive a couple different people, I think, at some point. Like, a battle for Miracle Cave, there are zero casualties. They have 20 seconds to get the battle going or whatever, or get their objective done before they realize, like, it had something to do with, like, human instinct or whatever, where there's 20 seconds where the human has to decide, I guess, if they're going to run or fight, I think, or something like that. Point is, though, is that it doesn't last 20 seconds. It takes, like, 20 minutes. the anime logic in 20 seconds, it was actually, like, 5 minutes of real time that you're watching these characters continuously move around, and then they're like, oh my god, it's been 2 seconds, even though we literally just watched them run around for, like, 2 minutes. It's kind of amusing. But I do believe that they, you know, might is science, that's a quote. We make nitroglycerin explosives, creating basically their own version of dynamite. And we've got the Tsukasa, this is when we get the Tsukasa sister thing, and that she was brain dead but is alive. She's kind of like in a coma. Poor background, wanted money to save his sister, so he had become like a professional fighter or something like that. The Miracle Cave gets blown up. They try to attack Mirai, which is the name of the little sister. I never mentioned that. Battle against the new big bad. Senku and Tsukasa are together during this. That's when he gets stabbed. They save Tsukasa by petrifying him. Or I say, they save Tsukasa by freezing him so that they can then petrify him for regen effects whenever they can learn how to do that. There's also a scene like where they're reviving different people and they revive this manga artist. I don't know what the point of this guy is, but he just immediately starts talking about how he's missed his deadline, you know, because 3,700 years it's been, and how he's in so much trouble, and he just starts blasting on paper, drawing manga. I don't know if this is supposed to be a nod to, like, the creator of Dr. Stone. Like, I'm assuming that this is probably based on a manga. Because I know that, like, manga artists are overworked, like, to shit. Like, Japan already has a work ethic garbage going on, and I know that manga artists themselves are probably some of the most overworked in the entertainment field, and so I don't know if this is just like a nod to the author himself or themselves or herself. I don't know if it's a he or she having overworked to meet deadlines for Dr. Stone, you know. I don't know, whatever, but he just kind of pops in, and he's a little background character that becomes part of the kingdom of science. And then that's it. That's pretty much everything else in my notes that I wrote down that I thought might have been worth mentioning in the video. But overall, yeah, it's more Dr. Stone as far as I can tell. I don't have any real issues with it, except maybe some of the characters' lips, but there's nothing new there. And it definitely got me kind of excited for the next piece of the story, right? You know, I'm very eager to see where this adventure takes us now that we're going out to sea, go to another country. So as far as my thoughts and opinions videos are concerned, the next episode will be Dr. Stone special episode Ryusui, I guess. I don't know how to pronounce that guy's name. But it is a continuation. It's a sequel. It's a 50-minute sequel to the series that I guess prepares us for the next season. As this particular show ends, you know, they're like, oh, we're going to need this, you know, we're going to need a ship, and every ship needs its captain, and then you get like this little tease of a character in Stone that, and then it cuts, and that's the character we're going to focus on in the special, which I'll be talking about in the next episode of the Thoughts and Opinions series. Now, after the Dr. Stone special, which will be the next episode. I have the episode after that will be on JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, Stardust Crusaders, Battle in Egypt, which I also finished today on the 4th of March when I'm recording this video. I'm not sure if I'm uploading this immediately or if I'll be saving this, but I guess I'll probably upload it Well, no, I'll decide if I'm uploading it immediately or not. We'll see. But I haven't made the videos yet for the special or that. I might make the video on the special next because I have enough energy right now, but there's no way I'm doing the JoJo video until maybe tomorrow, depending on how my mood goes tonight. Because that video, I've got a lot of shit to talk about, and it's something I kind of want to make sure that I'm fully there for, since I knew this video was going to be on the shorter end and not on the longer end. But other than that, though, guys, that's what's lined up for the next two episodes of the series. And there's, of course, other shows that I have started watching that will be making their way into the Thoughts and Opinions series very soon. Thanks for watching, guys. Remember, you can always suggest new manga, anime, and visual novels to me, and they get added to the respective list that I will hopefully get around to at some point with certain restrictions. And you can always post your own opinions on Dr. Stone, Stone Wars, in the comment section down below. And I will see you guys in the next Thoughts and Opinions video.